tonight, I'm hopeful it's going to be a very good class.
We always have good classes.
Well,
Yeah,
I appreciate that. But I think tonight is different in a sense because as a theologian, you look for, it's very hard to discover something new theologically or biblically. And at Princeton, you have all these great scientists there, and so you're in this atmosphere of discovery. And many of the theologians at Princeton, they find new theologies and new biblical precepts that, are not haven't been discussed. I think tonight, what I propose to you is in that category. You probably are not going to be able to understand my handwriting, that little chart that I made. But I'll explain it to you.
Have you seen it?
We've already discussed
you've already
it.
Seen it.
I have no problem with
so
it.
So, that's the best
I can
do. I got
the
no
word
problem
Luke.
Reading
we know
it.
The word Luke is on there somewhere.
So, yeah. Yeah, Jay?
I was going to ask Reverend Kelsey to translate the Arabic that's on there.
Yeah. I was actually being very neat because I contemplated that I would give this to you. So, on that page that you can't understand what it is, it's a groundbreaking theory. It's a groundbreaking theory that has never been mentioned in commentaries or biblical hermeneutical analysis, and it's taken me 2 weeks to unpack this and analyze this and put this together. So I think it's going to be very interesting for you. My hope is that I can get to this tonight, because this particular portion of Scripture that we're going to be studying tonight is really... it's astounding. So whether we get to it tonight or not, we'll get there when we get there. But I'm very excited about that. I worked very hard on this to put this theory together. But before we do that, I'm going to just open up with a reading from Scripture. And I think where I'm going to go to is Isaiah. And I'm going to go to Isaiah 53. And I think that is very appropriate for this time of year. Isaiah 53, and it talks about the vicarious sacrifice of Jesus Christ in, of course, the Old Testament. So let me read this to you. Who has believed our message, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up before him like a tender shoot and like a root out of a dry ground. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and familiar with suffering. Like one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised and we esteemed him not. Surely he took up our infirmities and he carried our sorrows, yet we considered him stricken by God, smitten by him, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each one of us has turned away, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of all of us. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this evening that we can come together in your house, Lord. We're very grateful and we're very thankful for the work that you've done not only in our lives, Lord, but in the lives of all throughout the world, Lord. And as we enter this holy season, this season of Easter, this season of your death, your burial, and resurrection, Lord, we're grateful that you love us so much that you went through all those steps, Lord, necessary to reconcile us to God. We ask you tonight to be with this time, be with myself, be with Reverend Dr. Kelsey as we talk and discuss these beautiful precepts of the Bible and these beautiful lessons that we can take from those and learn. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Reverend Dr. Kelsey, the floor is yours.
Thank you. I almost didn't make it tonight. I said to Martha, I want to go a little early and you can make a little something to eat before I go, a little early. She said, where are you going? I said, I have class tonight. She said, no, today's Tuesday. Said, no, it's Wednesday. She said, no, it's Tuesday. Why do you think it's Wednesday? Well, you can't argue with a woman, but... I called Amy. And Amy says, of course it's Wednesday. We got class tonight. I said, okay. And so I got here. But I almost didn't. I mean, if I had just listened to my wife, I would be sitting there watching Jeopardy. Now, the book I have in my hand is a book that is really an amazing book. And I'm going to give that to the church, but I want to give it to one person to read and then give it to someone else and just keep passing it around. And then it can be put in the church library. Why do they do the things they do? Why do Muslims kill each other? And the answer that she got was because they hate. And this Brigitte Gabriel was real sick and almost died. She's in southern Lebanon in the Lebanese hospitals, couldn't do anything for her. She crossed the border into Israel, and her description of how kind the Israeli hospital and doctors and nurses were is just fabulous. I mean, it's just an eye-opener to see that people who have something of the Old Testament principles in their mind are different than those who are anti-everything good. So this book is, my wife says I don't need to bring it back, but to tell you to pass it around and everyone use it. Now, this evening, we're coming to the end of Islam. And perhaps I should take a minute to explain why I spent time more than I had planned on, but I think we were learning things all the time. Why did I spend time on Islam when I'm giving church history? In the first 1,000 years of the church, a great part of the opposition and the problems that came because of Islam. And we have to realize that Islam did an awful lot to stop the growth of the church. They had some of these people who were just out there to destroy Christianity in every way they could. So we're going to finish off a few ideas I still had on Islam, and then begin something else after that. But we got so much coming, I see, in the next section, I will try not to go over. I've been pretty good. Yeah. So let's see now. On the last page, this is really called number 3 on my end, you have something about, we're talking about certain concepts in Islam, and so we begin with number 11, Millah. If you hear of Millah when you're reading something, then that's a word that is used to refer to a minority people, a minority community. So the Millah would be whether 5% of the population are Christian, that 5% is a Millah, a little community inside of a Muslim nation. Dhimma is another word that's also used a lot, and you'll bump into that if you're doing any reading or if you think about it and people talk to you about it. A dhimma is also a little group of people. The next concept is the word surah. Surah is a chapter in the Quran. And the way the Quran was written, Muhammad claimed to have had a vision or a revelation. I think that some of the first things he wrote, really his wife Khadija wrote them. She was much more educated than he was. She was really in charge, wealthy woman, a little older than him. But she ruled him with an iron hand. And we don't think about Muhammad as being ruled by a woman. But Khadija, as long as he's married to Khadija, no other woman got near him. I mean, she kept him under wraps. And then she finally died. And after that, I mean, he'd have about 40 wives by the time he got done. And so he was under her strong thumb for some time. And when it comes to the chapters of the Quran, she probably, when he dictated some things, she wrote it and smoothed out the language, because his language wasn't all that sharp. Even though people all think that Muhammad's Arabic is the standard Arabic for the whole Muslim community. So here he was getting these different things. Later on, he has others. Now the problem is, some of his chapters would have 10 verses, some would have 50, some had over 100. And the way they organized the book of the Quran, almost called the Bible, when they organized the Quran, they began by the longest chapter first. Then the next one, so one had 176 verses in it, and the next one would have 175. And you don't know when he wrote them. Did he write them when he was young or when he was older? Did he write them when Khadija was holding him under control, or when she was gone and he had a little more leeway to do what he pleased? It was in that second period of his life, when he married a 9-year-old girl and had a whole gang of wives and all, and that was the girl who was his wife when he was dying with his head in her lap, and I don't know how old she was then, but she was not very old. And he was there. Now, that's how the Quran, so if you're going to read the Quran, don't think it will be like the book of Luke or some other book in the scriptures that lead on from one thing to the next. I don't know how they can really study it. All they want to do is, what did Muhammad say about this? And then they hunt through all the verses of the Quran to see what he said. But nothing systematic, nothing theological in a theological order is there. Then this word, shahadi, all the Muslim will say is, just say the shahadi and you will be a Muslim. That is the testimony. And that word shahadi, interestingly enough, is used by Christians for our Christian testimony of salvation. But Muhammad uses it as a statement that shows that you are surrendered to Islam. And the shahadi would say something like this: there is no God but God, and Muhammad is his prophet. And someone will come up and make a verb out of the word shahadi and say, ishhad, la ilaha illallah wa Muhammad Rasulullah. And that's the shahadi. So all they have to do to become a believer. No one will ask them another question. No one will say, now you've got to deal with your sin. For them, there is no such thing as sin. That's a Christian concept, according to them. We would say it's a biblical concept. So that's the shahadi. Then number 14, the Trinity, they have a lot of trouble with that. And they are saying, we don't have a Trinity with three, but that we have polytheism with three distinct different gods. And so they call us polytheists because we have three gods rather than just the one. And they put a lot of thought on the fact that there's only one God. Then number 15, this we see discussed and argued about in America, in Canada, in the European countries, the Sharia. The Sharia is a form of Islamic law, and that Sharia is the law that should control everything that one thinks or does or speaks. And they will say, we want to have courts in America they go by the Sharia. That is, this law that they have put out as God's only law for us. There are things in that law that you just wouldn't believe. I mean, if someone is denied something in Islam, cut off his right hand. If he does it again, cut off his left foot. I mean, you don't want to cut both hands off. But, I mean, that's the way they think. So you cut the right hand and then the left foot. And then, I don't know what happens after the third one. But it doesn't look like he'll be very happy. So probably just cut off his
head.
Right.
Done.
They're good at that. I mean, they got a lot of experience. So that's the Sharia. And if you hear people talk about the Sharia law, it's one of the most evil things that man has ever created. And I could get my head cut off for saying that, but hopefully you won't put it in the newspaper tomorrow. If you do, put it under his name. Not mine. Okay. Now, we go down to number 16, jihad. And you see written in English, jihadist. They are the people who are doing the jihad, this holy war. And the holy war is the jihad. But the word is an old Arabic word from way before the time of Islam. And I don't think we should surrender the language to the Muslim just because he wants to hijack it. But the word, the word jihad is a struggle, and Christians use it. In the Epistle of Timothy, I believe it is, Paul says, fight the good fight. And in Arabic, Arabic Bible, which was translated before Muslims became, before the Islamic Revolution came in, before the Quran was written, it goes, jahid al jihad al hasid, fight the good fight, struggle the good struggle. And that's a Christian concept. But you're doing, that struggle is about the temptations you get, about the old nature and some of those things. Number 17, wahhab, the two H's in there, which means it's an intensive noun. And a wahhab is a person who's in Saudi Arabia, and they put forth a very strict interpretation of Islam. The Wahhab, he was a man who interpreted it and was very rigid. And that's what rules Saudi Arabia today. The Wahhabiyin are the worst of the worst down in that area. Then we come to Albena. And Albena gets very close to us here, and Mr. Kutub. Isn't there a place down here near Bayville or someplace right along there? It used to be a campgrounds, and that campground, I don't know, was run by Quakers or by some Christian group. And then these guys came there. Mr. Kutub was an Egyptian. Mr. What was the other guy's name? Mr. Benham. And they studied there a little bit. And then they went up to Greeley's Quaker school, up, I think it was in Wisconsin. And while there, they were studying, they saw the evils of Christianity. They saw the girls running around at that school. They saw the guys chasing them. They saw all kinds of what we would call immorality, and for them it was a shame even that girls would be in the same school with men. And they're just starting that in colleges in the Middle East now. The high school still is all segregated. And one school for boys, one school for girls. But Benna and Kutub came back and wrote books. They fathered, if you can use that word for a concept, they fathered the idea of the Muslim Brotherhood. And that Muslim Brotherhood is bothering us up till today. And it all began right down here, and I don't know the name of that place, but they had a little campground down there.
You know where it is? It's right by Ace.
You know where that is?
Yeah, I do. It's in Bayville. I think it's in Bayville.
Mm-hmm.
There are Ace's Hardware. It's across the street.
Is that right?
Yeah.
That's on Oka Harbor.
Oh, well,
I know where it is. Yeah.
Now that's a... That's a Unitarian place now.
Yeah, I know. It was some kind of...
You're talking about Mary Grove.
Yeah. I don't know what the name of it is.
And so they came back. Now, the Egyptian government has been fighting the Brotherhood for years. And I think that Mr. Qutb, and I'm not sure about the demise of Bena, but Mr. Qutb was hung because of the things he was teaching, his radical ideas trying to overthrow the government of Egypt. And people read his books today, and one of the things he talks about are the dancing girls in a Christian school in Wisconsin. So that was, so if you ever hear the name Qutb and Bena, you're not finding an evangelical evangelist.
You're saying they were over here studying Christianity?
Yeah, they were studying Christianity, and for them they saw how bad it was.
Were they studying because they were Christians, or they just wanted to know about it?
They just wanted to know about it, because they left Egypt to come here to study. With a chip on their shoulder.
What year was that? Do you know?
I would have said it's in the 20s.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
But his books are read and everybody reads them. And I mean, I've read maybe several hundred Arabic books. And every once in a while someone says, have you read Mr. Qutb's books? I said, well, no, I haven't got to those yet. I don't plan to get to them. But... It's quite interesting. So if you hear those names, you know who has caused every Egyptian government problems until now. And even when they tried to have an election and they had that one fella come up and he overthrew the president and everything was going wrong, that was all with this philosophy of Qutb and Bena. So just in case you run into their name. Now, the last thing I'll just mention today is predestination. And we probably talk about predestination, and we think of it, and those who are in the Reformed faith will have different concepts. The Arminian branch of Christianity, they have a different way of interpreting it. But for them... predestination is what God, El Hada, what God has determined would be your fate in life. And no matter what that fate was, there's nothing you can do to change it. And they say when you were born, God's angel wrote on your forehead everything that would happen to you. So, he had it right in the small print for me, I guess. What was the manner of death? Whatever happened. Now, I may have told you this story, and if I have, just raise your hand, I'll stop. But this airplane was taking off from the city of Beirut, which was right on the Mediterranean Sea. And the plane's runway went down toward the sea, and you just took off and flew over the sea. And this fellow was going to go on the plane, and he overslept, and he was sound asleep. And the plane took off in about 4 or 5 minutes out over the Mediterranean Sea and blew up, and everybody was killed. His mother said, oh, praise God that he didn't go get on that plane. She went in and shook him and said, wake up, guess what, that plane. She shook him. He had died in his bed at the same time the plane was going. And the Arabs have told me that story so many times, that when God writes on your forehead what's going to be, there's nothing you can do. You can't even stay in bed. And avoid the death that should have been yours if you've been on that plane. And so that's predestination, and that's one of the really the bad things. Now, I'm going to go for 5 more minutes.
Don't take as much time.
Yeah, okay. So I don't want to, you're coming up.
No,
with,
no.
Okay. I just want to say that we want to start to think a little bit about several other concepts. One of them is the Reformation. And the Reformation is, well, this is going to be a big year for the Reformation. The 500th year of Luther is going to be a great time. But there were some things that led up to the Reformation that led the church to deal with that subject, and people came along who were ready to get into the struggle. And so whether it's Calvin or whether whoever it might be. But let's just see some of the things leading up to the Reformation. You can call it the pre-dawn events leading up to the reform of the church. 4 reasons for the decline and fall of the papacy. Because the papacy became an irrelevant thing as far as Christianity was concerned. And people talk about the Pope as a descendant of Peter, and I don't think that that is defensible, but they like to defend it. There was a period of time as just before the Reformation when there were 3 popes in 3 different cities. So which one descended from Peter, we don't know. But there was a decline led by the priesthood. A demand for celibacy was one of the things that was not good. It led to all kinds of immorality. A demand of obedience to the Pope, and the Pope was only human and he could make many mistakes. This led to a decline in the morals of the whole church hierarchy. They lived luxuriously. So here you have a pope trying to tell people, you know, sacrifice and give to the church, and they lived at the extent of luxury. And they had 2 allegiances. One was to God, and one was to their own passions. And one of the things is, if I say this in some place, they might think I was being biased, but I'm a historian, an archaeologist. The archaeologist wanted to see the history of ancient times and determine that from the things he could dig up. And the historian continues to dig through documents to understand what was happening. But many of the popes had scores of children. And you wonder, of children today in Italy, whose great-grandfather or great-great-grandfather was a pope. And he started that whole idea, you shouldn't get married. Then there's what was called the Babylonian captivity. Now, we know that in Old Testament study, when the Israelites were taken over to Babylon. But in church history, when you hear the word Babylonian captivity, it was something different. The Pope had lost his prestige in the year 1300. Clement V moved the papacy from Rome to southern France. And that brought another Pope, and that brought that Pope under French control. But then back in Italy, they got 2 more Popes. And they ended up having 3 Popes at the same time, each one saying, he was the legitimate descendant of Peter. Well, they had cardinals. At one time, all the preachers and the priests, they voted for the next pope. And then it was about this time, about 1400, 1500, that they decided only the cardinals should elect the pope. And so that's how it's still being done today. And there could be a lot of things happening. Well, some wanted to go over and stay with the Southern France one, and others wanted to have one in Rome, and others in different parts of Italy. So, another thing that came in was leading up to the Reformation, that people got fed up with things. I mean, they could see how bad the church was. And this was something we all fight with, taxation. I handed my tax papers in today, and I don't know how much I'm going to have to pay, but I think when you get nothing, you don't pay much. You keep down there to zero. But anyway, I give it to somebody and he figures it out and tells me. But the taxes had to support two systems, and it was a great burden to the people, and they resented it. They resented the drain on their wealth. And there were four sources of income. First year, they would pay the priest and Peter's pence. It was not very much, but they would do it. And expenses for the Pope's traveling, his personal property. And the Pope had all kinds of property. And at the death of any priest, his stuff came to the church. And this really irritated people, their taxes and losing stuff when they died. Well, the people who died didn't worry, but the people who were there hoping they would get that inheritance, all of a sudden saw it went to the Pope, who had enormous bits of land. Then another thing is the rise of nation states. There were just these little city states, but pretty soon they started to have nation states where it was a lot of the small city places would join together and make a state. So that gave rise to, say, France and to Germany and Italy and these different places. And they really fell down. And the last thing that was very bad for it, not the last thing, next to the last, was the fact that there was the Black Death thing. Black Death, that sickness that came across Europe, and so many, many people died from it. So, we're going to stop there, and next week I want to begin talking about some of the forerunners who were evangelical in thinking and talk about them, like John Wycliffe, and that's one of my heroes, is Wycliffe. What he did. So we'll start with that next week.
Okay. Any questions?
It seems to me that the Catholic religion at that time sounds an awful lot like the Pharisees in Jesus' time. You know, a lot of the same issues.
Right.
Like they were preaching, they were teaching, you know, and preaching things that they were absolutely not doing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, were about money. Taxes were an issue. They were certainly an issue then.
That's why the masses were really upset. And you might say the Catholic Church prepared themselves for the coming of the Reformation. Everything was set up for that. Okay, I hope to see you next week. And,
Three more weeks. All right, guys, we got a little bit of time here to go through this. It's going to take us a while tonight. If you turn to page 69 of the synoptic handout, we're basically going to be sticking with and focusing on the woman with the ointment. And we're going to go through this. We're going to go through a pretty lengthy analysis and process as it relates to this particular scripture in correlation with a few others. So I think the order of the items that I'm going to go through would be, first we're going to read page 69, if you have that. Then I'm going to go to the second handout, the first handout that says hermeneutics, sack exchange. It says, are Simon the Pharisee in Luke and Simon the leper in the other Gospels the same person? That's going to be what we're going to try to decipher today, in a way. So that would be, it would be Luke 7 on that page. It's a one-page handout. Luke 7, Matthew 26, and Mark 14. Then the next handout we're going to go read is, we're going to read, it's duplicative. Luke chapter 7, verses 36 to 50, which is in the Synoptic Gospel. So you'll have a handout of that, and you'll also have in the Synoptic Gospel. The next handout says Mark 14, NIV. That says Jesus anointed at Bethany. We're going to read that. The next handout we're going to look at is Matthew 26, NIV. That's a handout. The last handout, as it relates to Scripture, is John chapter 12. So the handouts that we're going to be focusing on would be Luke chapter 7, Mark 14, Matthew 26, and John 12, in that particular order. Hopefully you have all those. Then there's a handout. It says two different women anointed Jesus. Okay, that's kind of a theological three-page analysis. The other documents I'm going to just read briefly from, so you don't have to worry about that, but there's going to be a structure and a progression that we're going to try to go through today. So hopefully you'll be able to keep up with me with these handouts. So the first one we're going to go to is, I'm going to ask somebody if they'd like to read Luke chapter 7, verses 36 to 50 on the synoptic page. Does anybody want to read that nice and loud?
Okay,
John, go ahead.
One of the Pharisees asked Jesus to eat with him, and he went into the Pharisee's house and took his place at the table. And a woman in the city, who was a sinner, having learned that he was eating in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster jar of ointment. She stood behind him at his feet, weeping, and began to bathe his feet with her tears and to dry them with her hair. Then she continued kissing his feet and anointing them with the ointment. Now when the Pharisees who had invited him saw it, he said to himself, if this man were a prophet, he would have known who and what kind of woman that is who was touching him, that she is a sinner. Jesus spoke up and said to him, Simon, I have something to say to you. Teacher, he replied, speak. A certain creditor had two debtors, one owed 500 denarii and the other 50. When they could not pay, he canceled the debts of both of them. Now, which of them will love him more? Simon answered, I suppose the one whom he canceled the greater debt. And Jesus said to him, you have judged rightly. Then turning toward the woman, he said to Simon, do you see this woman? I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet, but she has bathed my feet with her tears and dried them with her hair. You gave me no kiss, but from the time I came in, she has not stopped kissing my feet. You did not anoint my head with oil, but she anointed my feet with oil, with ointment. Therefore, I tell you, her sins, which were many, have been forgiven. Hence, she has shown great love. But the one to whom little is forgiven loves little. Then he said to her, your sins are forgiven. But those who were at the table with him began to say among themselves, who is this who even forgives sin? And he said to the woman, your faith has saved you. Go in peace.
Okay. So we have here what I think is a very important theological exchange between the various parties in this particular portion of Scripture. So let's begin to unpack some of the specific characteristics of this particular Scripture. So there's many of them, but what do you think? What are the important elements to this particular Scripture? There's many. Probably so many we probably couldn't list them all, but at least if we can list a few of them to begin to identify the significance and the importance of this particular scripture. And try not to be so hypothetical. Look, we're doing a hermeneutical study. Try to look at the text and be careful and be disciplined to see what the text is telling you. rather than just speculate or hypothesize with things. Pastor Rob?
From what we've been going through in class, this is one of the first times they're talking about him being in a Pharisee's house.
Right.
He's actually putting it out there that it's a Pharisee and he's in his house, not being a person.
Yeah, you're right. Last week, we were surprised of the exchange between Jesus and the centurion. Right now, it's up a notch where there's this literal a Pharisee, and he's going to eat at a Pharisee's house, correct? Right? That's a really good point. That's actually really good to start that way, because when you're analyzing these things, what I've noticed, just in class generally, and this probably happens in a lot of places, is that people dive into the text, and they may go three-quarters of the way all the way down and pull out a point where really a disciplined theologian is going to look to the first line or the first sentence and say, well, we know that there was this discussion with the Pharisee and Jesus, so that would be the first point. And I'm not saying that you have to go methodically in that order, but it's usually helpful when you're doing it this way to kind of take a little bit of discipline and begin with what's first and then progress on. So right now we know that the exchange was, there was a discussion between the Pharisee and Jesus about eating dinner, right? What else?
He took his place.
Well, he first went into the Pharisee's house, right?
Right.
Right.
He have a special place to sit at?
Right, he did, yes. Mm-hmm. Okay, so now we've gotten two or three points just from the first sentence or so. Now we're going to start getting to the meat of things. Now what happened next?
And the woman, how did the woman get there, who was a sinner,
yeah,
in the Pharisee's house?
This is how you want to do this. When you're working hermeneutically through Scripture, you want to kind of try to keep the progression. So now we know we have the Pharisee. We know that he went into the Pharisee's house. He sat at a particular place. And then there was this unrelated woman, right? It says, and a woman in the city. It doesn't really give much of identification as to who this woman is, right? We don't know who she is, right? Just a woman in the city, right? What else do we know about the woman?
She's a sinner.
All right. What do you think that means? We're all sinners, right? But what do you think this means?
She's a prostitute.
Well, okay. You probably went... You're right, Jerry. I would say that probably the safer answer would be that she was probably a woman that was involved in a lot of sin, okay? And she may have even been a prostitute, right? We don't know that because it doesn't say she's a prostitute in this particular portion, right? But we know that she's kind of a woman of ill repute, that we're all sinners, but they're using this in a specific way that she was a sinner, meaning she lived in this sinful lifestyle, right?
Yeah.
In the context. So you're right about that. So that's good. Okay. What next? Pastor Rob?
I was just going to say that, and obviously they knew her as a sinner. Like, she was known to be a sinner.
Yeah.
It wasn't just,
yeah.
She was sinning here and there. She was known to be a sinner.
I mean, she's identified as this woman, and we know her to be a sinner. And it's not just calling, generally we're all sinners. This is more specific and more of an identification.
That they knew her.
That they knew who she was and what she was. And Jerry makes a really good point that, she may have been a prostitute. That would make perfect logical sense, Jerry. The only reason why I didn't go all that way is because it doesn't say it right now. It doesn't say it here, right? So we would be speculating on that. But that's a good guess. Okay.
Women were not even really invited to these things.
Yeah,
a Pharisee's house. This was a woman.
Yeah, I mean, we don't know. That's another good point. We don't know if the woman knew the Pharisee. You know,
yeah,
we don't know whether the woman just heard about it and just barged in. I mean,
I think she knew him.
Or maybe she knew Jesus. Okay, so keep that in the back of your mind for later.
I'm sorry, what did you say?
Maybe she knew Jesus.
What
else,
guys?
She knew he was going to be there.
Yeah.
All right, so what happens now? So we have this woman in the Pharisee's house. They're eating. She kind of barges in a way. She has this reputation. And what is specific and unique about her?
She's weeping and crying. Like,
Too far ahead.
Okay.
She brought an alabaster jar. She brought an alabaster jar of ointment. This is the key to the whole portion of scripture here. What, Rob?
Which was very expensive back then.
Oh, I mean, well, we're gonna find out later on how expensive that was. But yes, it was very expensive and it was very unusual. So we have this Pharisee. I mean, just look at the picture. We have this Pharisee. We have Jesus eating dinner at the Pharisee's house. We have Jesus sitting at the particular portion or the particular place that the Pharisee sat at. We have a woman of ill repute barging into this particular dinner with this ointment, this alabaster the jar of ointment. And we're only three lines into this story. This is an extraordinary story. What next?
She was weeping and crying.
Yeah.
Like she knew who Jesus was. Like maybe she was.
She stood behind him at his feet.
How about that?
So she's behind him, right? Are you getting a picture of this?
Yeah.
And she's weeping, and she began to bathe her feet with her tears and dry them with her hair. This
That's
is extraordinary.
A lot of crying.
Mm. I mean, here is this woman from the city who was a sinner who's doing something that none of the apostles would even ever imagine to do, nor the Pharisee, right? So something special is going on right here.
She's showing him a lot of respect.
Well, you know what? I think it's far more than respect. I think it's love, but I even think it's more than that. I think it's recognition. I think it's recognition on her part of what she is and who he is.
Yes.
Laura.
I have down here, like, maybe she had seen him or met Jesus, and she had repented of her sins. And she came, and she knew he was going to be there, so she came, and she was thanking him for what he had done for her.
Well, I mean, that's really good. That's a lot right now for where we are, but in the end, we may be there at the end. But that's good. See, what I'm trying to train you to do is I'm trying to train you how we would be trained at Princeton to analyze this stuff. And you can get there, it just takes a little bit of time. And the reason why it takes time is because you want to methodically go through the necessary steps and not just jump because you want to learn all these things. So that's really good, Laura. Just keep that in the back of your mind. Okay, now where are we at? We have the woman, she's crying, her tears are dripping onto Jesus, she's wiping him with the hair. Then what does she do?
Kissing him.
Yeah. Well, right, Mary? Well, she's kissing his feet. I mean, she's not kissing him like, you know, like we would kiss one another. She's kissing his feet.
She says she's continuing to do it, so she's been doing it.
She continued kissing his feet. And what is she doing while she's kissing the feet?
Anointing
them with ointment. I mean, that's... So this is what she's done. This is what the sinful woman from the city that wasn't invited to the dinner is doing. So far, what has the Pharisee done?
Nothing.
Talking about Jesus.
Probably beginning to think bad thoughts, right? Like,
Yes. Who
is she to do this?
Yeah.
Right.
And if he knew who she was, he wouldn't.
Right. And if the Pharisee knew who she was, it'd be even more. Can you believe that? You know, it's like he's eating with sinners and, you know, tax collectors again, right? So, all right, so now we're up to this point where we're 39. Mm-hmm. So now, what does the Pharisee do? What's his response?
If he was a prophet,
right?
He would have known that she is a sinner.
The woman, that's
a woman.
Okay, you're
on
to something. So, but what? So explain to me, Rose and Jared, what does that mean?
If she's a sinner, Jesus would have known that and would not allow her.
Exactly. That's really
to
good.
Touch him.
That's outstanding. That's not an easy question to answer. I mean, Rosie said it perfectly. The Pharisee says, if this man were a prophet, if Jesus was really a prophet, he would have known what kind of woman this was. He'd never let her do these things.
Mm-hmm.
So now you have a little tension, right? You have, once again, you know, I was writing today about that. The the way the gospel portrays things, it's really adverse in a way to the way we think and the way the world operates. You have the Pharisee, the religious leader. Jesus goes to his house. You would think that he would be knowledgeable to know what's right and what's wrong and how to handle things. And then you have the sinner that may, in fact, be she may be a prostitute. Well, she was a bad woman. And yet she's doing everything right. And then the Pharisee even gets this wrong, right? He says that if Jesus was really a prophet, he'd know what kind of woman this was. And he basically, you know, who's touching him, that she's a sinner. And then what happened after that?
Jesus spoke.
You know what's interesting, though? We missed this. I was wondering if anybody was going to get this. It says, now when the Pharisee who had invited him saw it, he said to himself. Mm-hmm. He never said this out loud. Nobody heard what he was thinking. Mm-hmm. Right? So he didn't say those things that we just talked about. That was all going on inside of his mind, right? But what happens after that?
Jesus
knew what he was thinking. And what did Jesus say to him?
Speak.
He said, I have a story that I want to tell you. Right?
Yes.
He said, Simon, I have something to say to you. And then Simon replies, okay, teacher, go ahead. You know, it was within the, you know. And then he tells him this story about these two debtors, right? One who owed 500 and the other who owed 50. And Jesus asked the question, you know, if they couldn't pay and he canceled both of these debts, which of them would love him more? And Simon answers the question right. What did he say?
The one who owed the most.
Right, the one who owed the most money. Right, just think of yourself, if you have a credit card and you owe $500 on it, and you have a credit card that you owe $50 on it, and the credit card company says to you, hey, listen, we made a mistake. You know, these are, you don't owe any of the money. You're going to be happier with this one for $500 that they canceled out than the one for $50. Well, that's in a way what happened here. And so Jesus is teaching Simon these things. Now he even, so Simon gets this whole, this analysis right on the canceling of the debt. Then what happens?
Jesus made an analogy. What
right?
happened?
Well, he
came
right.
in.
So he makes the analogy about the two canceled debts, right?
Yes.
Then Jesus says to Simon, you've answered the question
yes.
rightly. You've judged rightly, right? Then what happens? Then how does the picture change?
Well, he told Simon, when I came into your house.
Well, no, we're not that far yet. We're not that far yet. What happened?
He turns back to the woman. But talks to Simon.
Right. So that's an interesting, you know, can you see that? It says, then turning toward the woman. So he turns and looks at the woman, right? But then he addressed Simon. That's a very odd thing. Usually when you turn to somebody, you're going to address that person. But he turns to the woman, almost looking at her, loving her in a way, right? And then he says, Simon, right? Do you see this woman? Now he's using her as an example.
Right. She knew her sin. He did not.
Right. We get to that a little bit later. But before we even get to that, Jesus says, Simon, look at the woman. And then he uses another analogy. What does he do at that point in time? Here's what he does. Here's what he says. It's not in the scripture. I'm going to paraphrase. You're a Pharisee. You're religious. You're the brightest of the bright. You know everything about theology and religion and the laws. And yet this woman who's from the city and a sinner knew how to treat me properly and righteously. And you didn't. Right? Because he says this. I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet. But she's bathed my feet with tears and dried them with her hair. Wow. You gave me no kiss. But from the time I came, she's not stopped kissing my feet. Now, here's an interesting part that this confused me a little bit. Jesus continues and says, you did not anoint my head with oil, but she has anointed my feet with ointment. So the woman never anointed the head of Jesus with oil, and that's a significant, I think that's very significant. Why do you think that's significant?
She felt like she wasn't good enough to do that.
Okay. What do you
think?
She
did his
well, what, I mean, look, don't you think that this is a very odd sentence? It says, you did not, I would have thought he would have said, you did not anoint my feet with ointment, but she did, right? It's not what he said. You did not anoint my head with oil, but she anointed my feet. I think this has some references to the anointing of Aaron, the anointing, the priestly duties, the high priestly duties. When they would anoint the high priest, they'd pour oil on his head and it would drip all the way down. And I think that she was so spiritually led by the Holy Spirit, and she knew her place. She knew that she could only go to his feet. And you know what? Remember when John the Baptist said to Jesus, this is where you have to start correlating different things. Remember when Jesus, when John said to Jesus, when Jesus came to be baptized by John, John says, I'm not worthy to baptize you. I'm not even worthy to tie your sandals on your feet. It signified the lowest form of humility. She was not going to be boastful and proud and assume that she could anoint Jesus with the oil upon the head like a priest would be anointed. But rather, she took the humility, the humble way, and just anointed his feet. I think that's really special. And I think that Jesus wants us to understand that significance there, because when he says, you, Pharisee Simon, who would be able to anoint my head with oil and recognize I am Messiah, I am priest, I mean, that's an interesting thing. Could the Pharisee have anointed Jesus' head with oil?
But in his pride, he wouldn't do that.
His pride wouldn't let him. I think that that's why Jesus says here, you did not anoint my head with oil. That's implicit that he could have. If I say to you, you didn't give me a glass of water, I was thirsty. That implies that you could have gotten me a glass of water. You could have went right into the kitchen and gotten me a glass of water, but you chose not to. And I think that this is very similar. When Jesus says to Simon, you didn't anoint my head with oil, you could have, but she anointed my feet. Pastor Rob?
And I think what makes it maybe even a little spicier is that in the beginning, Jesus had a conversation with this Pharaoh, and the Pharaoh asked him over to dinner. So obviously, they know each other. He knows who Jesus is as far as who they think he is right now, because in all of our other studies up to this point, Pharaohs wanted nothing to do with Jesus. They didn't hang out with him.
Right.
They just went to question him and try to trip him up. But this guy's willing to take him in. So obviously he believes them to a point.
You know, it's you know, the Pharisees, I mean, it almost reminds me of Nicodemus. Remember Nicodemus came to Jesus too, and he was inquiring.
Yes.
See, these are religious, these are the theologians of the day, the Pharisees. And they're perplexed by this Jesus because they're familiar with Old Testament. They're familiar with the prophecies. They're familiar with what Messiah would look like
right.
And what he would be. And I think that they're inquisitive. That's why this Pharisee wanted Jesus to come over his house. He wanted to pick his brain. But it seems like Jesus knew this Pharisee named Simon. Rich?
I just want to add to the anointing part. I think it's more profound that the anointing represents the kingship of Jesus. I don't know if the Pharisees or Peter understood Jesus being the high priest at this point. That teaching doesn't come to the apostles, to Paul, Paul's writing and epistles. But you do understand him as king. They want him to be king. Peter does. The Pharisees worry about him being king. So I think the woman, I agree with you, was a submissive act. She anoints his feet. But the anointing of the head, the statement Jesus makes, has, I think it's more profound to think of it as his being king. The second thing, which is probably a little more in-depth, is that she, everything she did was a manifestation of her faith. Those works, Jesus saw the works. And because at the last, I think it's verse 50, says, thy faith had save thee, because Peter, he may confess faith, but he didn't have the works. He sat there. The Pharisee sat there.
Well,
she did what she needed to do because she loved Jesus. She knew who he was. She believed in him. She submitted to him, etc., etc. It was a manifestation of her.
Well, I agree with some of that. I mean, I think that the anointing, though, I think it's specific in that a Pharisee would have understood the anointing the head with oil or the ointment. They would have understood that that was a priestly function.
Wasn't David anointed when he became king and Saul? So the anointing also goes along with the kingship.
When you separate the kingship, I mean, they get a little gray, meaning there's a mixture, but he wasn't looking for his kingship as far as the world was concerned and a ruler over Israel. He was more or less spiritually the Messiah.
Well, I'm not talking about it in the physical.
I know, but I don't want to argue about that.
Wouldn't that have given him legitimacy?
Well, I think that, look, if he anointed him with oil in the head, then the Pharisee would have been recognizing that Jesus is the spiritual priest in a way. And they would have to submit to him as the high priest. I mean, if there's any reference of the priestly duties, and as a Pharisee, they would recognize the high priestly duties. If they anointed his head with oil, they would recognize that he is special and set aside for those high priestly duties. I don't think the kingship was really in play in this particular prayer. I think it's more spiritual and more in his position as priest. But those are good things. Let's move on now. So we have. We have this particular portion where he says, "You did not anoint my head with oil, but she has anointed my feet with ointment. Therefore, I tell you, her sins, which were many, have been forgiven, and she has shown great love." Right? But then Jesus talks about when there's a little bit of forgiven, they love little. So he's trying to make this analogy. And I think what he's trying to do is trying to tell Simon that you may be righteous and you may be holy, and you may think that you don't have much sin. And that may very well be true. But when you have little and you're forgiven little, you love little. And so Simon is getting really beat up. The religious leader is really getting beat up in this portion of Scripture with Jesus. And then he goes back to the woman again, right? What does he say to her?
Your sins are forgiven.
She never asked for her sins to be forgiven, did she? But as Rich said, her actions, her conduct, her faith was showing that she knew she was a sinner and she knew she needed to be reconciled to God. And Jesus gave her the relief that she was really looking for and acting out that she wanted to be right with God. And she knew how despicable she was. She knew how much of a sinner she was. She humbled herself before the Lord. She came here. She did these beautiful acts of faith. And Jesus said, "Woman, your sins are forgiven." Right? Then what happened?
Now they wondered how he can forgive sins.
Right. See, that's a good point, Rose. You said they wondered. Not just Simon the Pharisee, but everybody else that was at the table. Right? So everybody else except for Jesus and the woman, everybody else at that table, they began to say among themselves, "Who is this who even forgives sins?" So now, this kind of confirms my thoughts about his priestly duties, right? The king can't forgive sin. Only the priest was able to forgive sin, right? So now, he's operating that priestly role, that high priestly role. So now, they're even recognizing this, well, who can forgive even sins? Well, he can. And he said to the woman, "Your faith has saved you. Go in peace." What a beautiful display. So now we have a good understanding, right, of this particular scripture. Now let's kind of get to the hard part. Right, we're going to move on. We've mastered this scripture. Okay? Now let's go to the second handout where it says, "Are Simon the Pharisee in Luke and Simon the leper in other gospels the same person?" Now this really gets quite interesting. We have a few scriptures that I'm going to have you guys read out. We still have about a half an hour. I'm going to just read this very quickly. It says, Luke chapter 7, verse 37 to 38. "And behold, the woman of the city, who was a sinner, when she learned that he was reclining at the table in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster flask of ointment and kissed his feet and anointed them with ointment." That was Luke chapter 7. That was similar to what we just read. Just a few verses out of that whole context, right? Matthew 26 says, "Now when Jesus was at Bethany in the house of Simon the leper, a woman came up to him with an alabaster flask, a very expensive ointment, and she poured it on his head as he reclined at the table." Now Mark 14. "And while he was at Bethany in the house of Simon the leper, and he was reclining at a table, a woman came in with an alabaster flask of ointment of pure nard, very costly, and she broke the flask and poured it over his head." Were Simon the Pharisee and Simon the leper the same person? That's not really the question. The question is, really, was the woman the same person? That's the question that you want to figure out. We'll get there. We're going to get there. It may surprise you. All right. So let's go. We already read Luke chapter 7, verses 36 to 50. So let's skip over that. Now let's go to Mark 14. And who wants to read Mark 14? Do you guys have that?
Where?
What page are you
on? On the handout. Mark 14.
Oh.
Who wants to read Mark 14? We're going to read Mark 14. We're going to read Mark, and then we're going to read Matthew, and then we're going to read John. So does anybody want to read Mark 14? Go ahead, Laura. Read it nice and loud.
"Now the Passover and the Festival of Unleavened Bread were the only 2 days, away.
All right, why don't you read a little bit louder, Laura? Start from the beginning again.
Wait
a minute.
Where is
it? You guys,
Mark 14.
I hand out all this stuff. I organize it for you every single week. It's all right there.
No, in this one.
Mark 14.
One just,
it's in a handout.
Today.
The one he just handed out, the second.
Jeannie.
The scriptures are all together.
Mom.
Mark 14. Okay, read it, Laura.
Okay. "Now the Passover and the Festival of Unleavened Bread were only 2 days away, and the chief priests and the teachers of the law were scheming to arrest Jesus secretly and kill him. But not during the festival, they said, or the people may riot. While he was in Bethany, reclining at the table in the home of Simon the leper, a woman came with an alabaster jar of very expensive perfume made of pure nard. She broke the jar and poured the perfume on his head. Some of those present were saying indignantly to one another, 'Why this waste of perfume? It could have been sold for more than a year's wages and the money given to the poor.' And they rebuked her harshly, leave her alone, said Jesus. 'Why are you bothering her? She has done a beautiful thing to me. The poor you will always have with you, and you can help them anytime you want. But you will not always have me.' She did what she could. She poured perfume on my body beforehand to prepare for my burial. Truly I tell you, wherever the gospel is preached throughout the world, what she has done will also be told in memory of her. Then Judas Iscariot, one of the 12, went to the chief priests to betray Jesus to them. They were delighted to hear this and promised to give him money. So he watched for an opportunity to hand him over."
Okay. So now, what's the difference with this one compared to the one we just read? There's a lot of differences here.
Anointed her his head.
Yeah, okay. Well, we want to start, remember, we want to start with the beginning, right? So now, there's a time, it's explaining to us the time, it's the Passover and the festival on unleavened bread. So it's a different time, okay? Chief priests, teachers of the law, they're trying to arrest and secretly kill Jesus. They didn't want to do it during the festival. So you have this whole background, they're giving you this time period, it's a different time than the one that we just read before. And also, where is he?
He's in Bethany.
He's in a different location. Right? And he's reclining at the table of Simon, Is it the same Simon or a different Simon?
Different
Simon. Simon the leper, not Simon the Pharisee. Mm-hmm. But what happens after that?
Woman with a jar.
Woman with a jar.
The same jar. Almost the same jar.
Well, I'll tell you, Jerry, it's that's a good point. It's a woman. She's not identified in this scripture. She has an alabaster jar, a very expensive perfume. She broke the jar, right?
One was an ointment and one was a liquid.
Yeah, I wouldn't get too caught up with that. They're pretty much the same. Let's just assume they're the same, all right? Because in all likelihood they are. But she broke the jar, and she poured the perfume on his head. So that we know that's different, because in the other one, it doesn't say she broke the jar. And we know for a fact she didn't put it on his. She didn't pour it on his head. She poured it on his feet.
Right.
Jesus asked, Simon the Pharisee, "Why didn't you anoint my head with oil?" Right. But here, this woman does this. Right.
It doesn't identify the woman as a sinner.
It doesn't. That's a good point, Rich. It doesn't identify her as. It doesn't identify her as two things: a woman in the city. So this. Supposed to be this woman in the city, and she's a sinner. So there's two strikes against her. We don't have those in here, right? Just it says a woman. So she breaks the alabaster jar, she pours it onto his head, and those that are around saying, what are they saying?
Why
is she wasting it, right?
Yeah.
Look at how much it cost. It could have been sold for a year's wages. I mean, that's a lot of money. That's a lot of money. I mean, look at how just so perceptive and so understanding those around are. It could have been sold for a year's wages, and the money could have been given to the poor. Right? I wonder if Judas was saying that.
No.
And they rebuked her. And then what happened?
He said, leave her alone.
Yeah, but what's the significance of what she did? What is she doing?
Anointing him.
Why?
Burial.
Yeah. This is foreshadowing his death. His death. She's preparing him for burial. Boy, the Holy Spirit must be moving upon this woman. And then Jesus says something that would really frustrate and alienate a lot of people. He says, the poor will always be with you. You're not always going to have me. What she's done is very special, and it's going to be talked about throughout the world. And then, of course, we have Judas entering the picture here. And he's going to betray Jesus, right? So we've mastered this particular portion of Mark. We know the differences between Mark 14 and Luke chapter 7. Now let's go to Matthew 26. You have a question?
I have a question. I'm curious about him being a leper and he's going into his house.
Well, I mean, didn't Jesus heal the lepers?
Yeah.
Didn't he heal? He healed them.
But then was he the healed leper, or was he...
Well, I think that's a different question. I would guess that Simon the leper is being referred to as Simon the leper, but he's been healed.
He's been healed.
Yeah. I mean, you have to think of it this way. Jesus went around healing everybody. Everybody who had faith, everybody that believed was being healed. He's not going to... This person's not going to be ingratiated to Jesus, follow Jesus, love Jesus, and still be a leper, and Jesus isn't healing them. It doesn't make any sense. I think that he's referring to Simon as the leper, as different from Simon the Pharisee that was in the other story.
That's how he wound up at his house, I think.
Because
he healed them.
You're right. Yeah. Okay, so who wants to read Matthew chapter 26, verses 7 to 13, nice and loud? Who wants to read that? Anybody? Go ahead, Jay. Read nice and loud.
Can I read loud or what? A woman came to him with an alabaster jar of expensive perfume, which she poured on his head as he was reclining at the table. When the disciples saw this, they were indignant. "Why waste this?" they asked. "This perfume could have been sold at a high price and the money given to the poor." Aware of this, Jesus said to them, "Why are you bothering this woman? She has done a beautiful thing to me. The poor will always be with you, but you will not always have me. When she poured the perfume on my body, she did it to prepare for my burial. Truly I tell you, wherever the gospel is preached throughout the world,
what she has done will always be told in her memory, in memory of her.
Okay, so that's pretty. Now look, from what we've learned, you know, that probably was lifted out of Mark, that portion of scripture. So it's very similar to what Mark has. It doesn't really have. It has all the elements that Mark has. Mark is just a little bit more descriptive. So let's move on now. We have to go to John. See, what I've done was I've tried to assemble all the particular scriptures that refer to this particular anointing and see if we can discern anything from it and see if we can compare these. See, I have these three scriptures of Mark, Matthew, and John in juxtaposition to Luke, right? We have Luke. Luke's one was Simon the Pharisee. These other ones are Simon the leper. So now who wants to read John chapter 12? Because John chapter 12 is really the key that begins to unlock everything with us. Mary, do you want to read all that?
Sure.
John chapter 12, verses 1 to 10. Go ahead, Mary.
6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, where Lazarus lived, whom Jesus had raised from the dead. Here a dinner was given in Jesus' honor. Martha served while Lazarus was among those reclining at the table with him. Then Mary took out a pint of pure nard, an expensive perfume. She poured it on Jesus' feet and wiped his feet with her hair. And the house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. But one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, who was later to betray him, objected. Why wasn't this perfume sold and the money given to the poor? It was worth a year's wages. He did not say this because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief, as a keeper of the money bag. He used to help himself to what was put in it. Leave her alone, Jesus replied. It was intended that she should save this perfume for the day of my burial. You will always have the poor among you, but you will not always have me. Meanwhile, a large crowd of Jews found out that Jesus was there and came, not only because of him, but also to see Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. So the chief priests made plans to kill Lazarus as well.
All right, so you have this one throws a monkey wrench into everything, right? What do you think about this? This is interesting. What do you notice about this particular portion of scripture?
Sorry, name and the woman.
Okay, so before we get there, right? We know that it's the same, it looks like the same situation as what we had before, because it's 6 days before the Passover. Jesus came to Bethany. And now it's identified at where Lazarus lived, whom Jesus raised from the dead, right? So that's fairly consistent with the situation that we have in Mark and also the situation that we have in Matthew. Now, and John's right, there's a dinner that was given in Jesus' honor. And we have people that are identified. Martha was there, not Dr. Kelsey's wife, but Martha, which was Lazarus' sister, right?
Correct.
Lazarus was there. He was reclining at the table with them. Then Mary, this woman is identified. This woman with the alabaster jar in Bethany is identified as Mary. Took a pint of nard and expensive perfume. She poured it on Jesus' feet and wiped it with her hair. Now, it doesn't mention in here. What doesn't it mention?
On his head.
It doesn't mention on his head. Now, she could have put it on his head too, but it's just not mentioned here. But it's not mentioned. It was poured on his feet, and his feet were wiped with her hair. But if it's the same situation that we have in Bethany, then she did anoint Jesus' head, right? It says she broke the jar and poured the perfume on his head. If they're the same, in fact, incident. Then we have here, the house was filled with fragrance of the perfume, and then we have Judas Iscariot objected, why wasn't this perfume sold and the money given to the poor, which is what he said, right? He said that already. He said that right before in Mark, right? Yeah, he said the same thing in Mark. So it seems to me that these Bethany instances are all the same. Would you agree with that? Go ahead, Rich.
I have a question.
Yeah.
In Mark, it says 2 days before the... And not that it's going to be, you know...
Right.
It's not going to It's the same sign.
It's the same
time. Shadow
period.
My faith.
Yeah.
But once it's 2 days.
And once it's 6 days.
Yeah.
It's the same time period, though. It's
but
just
then the discrepancy is once as anointing. I mean, a big difference anointing the crown of your head versus anointing your feet. There's a second discrepancy in there.
It's
well,
not
but, so
necessarily.
This is what I'm submitting. That could be two different incidents.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, but not for the Bethany. The Bethany, this is all one incident in Bethany. There's nothing to support that it was redundant at Bethany. Okay, so but hold that thought, though, because I think you're thinking in the right direction. Okay, so now we have all these differences. But the question is the anointing in Luke the same as Matthew, Mark, and John? Is it the same woman? Pastor Rob?
I would say no, because it doesn't speak in any of the other ones of how she was so reverent of him as far as...
All right, I think what you're saying, that's a good point.
And move, you know.
Okay.
In Luke, she was a sinner.
Okay. So yeah. let's go look at... Let's look at this. Let's go to this paper. There's two different women anointed Jesus. One was decent, the other was not. This is pretty much the standard theological explanation. Okay? Do you have that handout? I've spoken with many people who confuse the two different cases in which a woman anointed our Lord, and as a result think that it only deals with one case. Because of this confusion, some consider that Mary, the sister of Lazarus, the friend of Christ, was a prostitute, when in reality she was a decent woman. It was the other woman, the one who anointed Jesus in Galilee to the north, who was a prostitute. I'm not so sure about that. But this is pretty much the accepted theological position. You follow that? Lazarus and his sisters lived in Bethany, close to Jerusalem. So, you know, it's two different instances. We can't dispute that.
Two different women also.
It could be two different women.
Yeah, because the other one is from Galilee, it says here, and the other one's in Bethany. That's what
well, yeah, but that's not inconsistent. I mean, just because she's from somewhere doesn't mean she can't be in another place at a different point in time.
But
see, the woman is unknown in the first gospel that we read,
yeah,
right? We don't have her identified, but she later identified in John. She's not identified in either Mark or Matthew either. But because she's identified in John, and John is the same as Matthew and Mark, we know that she's Mary, Lazarus' sister, right?
Yeah, it says here.
Okay, so let's just stick with that for a little while. We know that the Simon, which is confusing too, there are two different Simons. One's a leper and one's a Pharisee, right? All right. So let's go to the second page, and this is what this theologian writes. He writes the case in Matthew. Now, when Jesus was in Bethany in the house of Simon the leper, you know, we have the alabaster box, precious ointment, and in that particular one, she did it for the burial. She did it for the burial also in Mark and also in John. But what was the reason why she did the ointment in Luke? You answered the question already. The reason that she anointed Jesus in Matthew, Mark, and John was because to prepare for burial, right? It said in all
right.
the three scriptures, correct?
Right.
What was the reason why she anointed Jesus in Luke?
Yes, mission.
Okay. Well.
Respect, submission, honor.
Because she was a sinner.
Forgiveness of sins.
Forgiveness
of sins. That's the reason why. She anointed Jesus' feet for the forgiveness of sins as compared to the burial. The preparation for burial. Okay? So, this is very interesting. Now, we have some scriptures as it relates to the pouring on the oil of the head. We have Psalms, we have Ecclesiastes, and there's others. But the custom, there are allusions to the pouring of this ointment on the head of Christ was emblematic of his being anointed with an oil of gladness and messianic shift. and having the Holy Spirit, and his gifts and graces are without measure, like the ointment poured on Aaron's head. It ran down his beard and the skirts of his garments, and it was to all the descendants that there was this symbolic or symbolism poured forth in this particular, in this priestly office. Now, we know that Aaron did great miracles. I mean, it was Aaron's rod, and it was much of what Aaron did that delivered the Israelites out of captivity with Pharaoh and the Egyptians with Moses, right? So Aaron was very powerful. And Aaron was anointed with that oil of gladness, and it ran down his eye. It's a beautiful picture of it, the oil being broken and running down his face and running down his face. But we don't have that in all the particular scriptures. Now, what I want to do is I want to go to my little theory here that I put together. And I'm going to try to see if we can get through this in a few minutes, and then we're going to end class here. I've put together a very novel theory that I've never come across or ever read, and maybe I can develop this a little bit more and maybe some of the PhD work I'm going to do. But I have a theory, and it's this. I think it's the same woman in all the instances of the anointing of the oil. But I think it took place in two different periods. I think one took place, of course, at Simon the Pharisee's house, and I think the other one took place at, of course, Simon the leper's house. Now, why do I say that? I say that because I've kind of developed this progression. And the progression is this. If you look on this particular chart, or this little thing this rudimentary thing I've drawn, we have, of course, it says Luke's version is right here. And we have the Pharisee at Simon's house. We have the woman as a sinner that she's not identified, okay? We know that this is an earlier in time than the situation that happened in Bethany. So what I'm thinking is there is possible room for this progression, because this woman does such an unusual thing. She has this particular, it's the same type of alabaster jar or box. It's the same type of perfume. And it seems like the chances of this woman acting exactly the same way in all these scriptures, it seems highly unlikely that one person would have the same characteristics. I mean, she came, she went to his feet, she cried, her tears were on his feet, she was washing his feet with her hair as she's anointing his feet with oil in the earlier version for the forgiveness of sins, okay? And this woman was a bad woman, but yet she was forgiven of her sins. And then we have a break. And then at a newer time, we have another instance that happens in Bethany with the same, very characteristically the same type of woman. And she's unidentified in four out of the five scriptures, or at least, I guess she's unidentified in, I think it's four out of five. Yeah, one, two, three. She's unidentified in three out of the four scriptures. Now we're at Bethany. Why couldn't it be the same woman? Why couldn't it be the same woman? And the reason why she's not being referred to as the woman in the city, the sinful woman, is because she's been forgiven of her sins. She doesn't have that stigma anymore. But as the Holy Spirit moved upon her in the beginning, and the first anointing that's depicted in Luke, the Holy Spirit moved upon her a second time at a different location because she knew by the power of the Holy Spirit that Jesus was going to be crucified and die, and she was preparing Jesus for the burial. That's why she didn't anoint him on the head with oil the first time, but the second time she did. And now this woman is identified, although she wasn't necessarily identified in Matthew or Mark. We know this woman is Mary. It's Lazarus' sister. And this beautiful thing happens again, only it's a few days away from Passover. It's very close in proximity to when Jesus is going to be crucified and dead. So my question is, theologians focus on whether or not Simon was the same person. They weren't. The real question is, was this woman the same person? And I suggest to you that she may have been. And the extraordinary part of this is I don't think that's ever been proffered before, that the woman is the same woman. This could have been the same woman, the scriptures are very characteristic. They're very specific as to her conduct expressed. She could have been transformed, thus losing the stigma of a woman from the city that's a sinner. Yes, it's a different place. It's a different time. But I think that adds to the prospect that it may have been the same person. It's the same spiritual progression, the same person and purpose in a way. She was anointing and recognizing Jesus for who he was, the first being the forgiver of sins, and secondly, preparing him for his death. This is an extraordinary, extraordinary analysis and an extraordinary proposition. If this is the case, it's really enlightening that this woman would have done the same thing twice in a way. How extraordinary is that? It's just a theory. I've been working through it for a few weeks now, but it seems to me that it's not inconsistent, and I can't find an inconsistency with it. Just because one part of scripture leaves out that she anointed his head in the second anointing doesn't mean it didn't happen, because we know that it did happen in the second anointing. Scriptures don't always have exactly the same characteristics, or we wouldn't need Matthew, Mark, and Luke. They'd all be the same. But there's different nuances, but they're never inconsistent with one another. And I don't think anything that I've read, and I've read this 100 times over the last few weeks, I don't think there's anything inconsistent with this theory. It's just food for thought, but it's a beautiful analysis. And it's a very interesting point that the woman identified as Mary may in fact be the same woman that's identified in Luke's version. And the beautiful progression. Wouldn't it be a beautiful story if it was the same person? Here you have this woman that's a prostitute or a woman of ill repute, a woman that living in the city, identifying Jesus as the forgiver of sins, right? The first time. And then the second time, identifying Jesus that he's going to die for the sins of humanity and anointing him and preparing for burial. I mean, it almost reminds me of when the Holy Spirit overtook Peter, when Peter fouled up so many different times. And Jesus was saying, well, who do the people say that I am? And then Jesus said, who do you say that I am? And Peter said, for you are the Christ, Son of the living God. I mean, and that's the type of unction that the Holy Spirit gave onto these people. And I think this woman from the city, the sinner, was really extraordinary and very special. And I think that when Jesus mentions that they will talk about her throughout all ages and throughout all time, I think that she was very special. And I suggest to you, and I think that it may have been the same woman that did both acts. Just in two different places at two different times, but the same characteristics. It would be highly unlikely that another person would act exactly the same way she acted. Rich?
How many Marys were at the cross?
Three
Marys at the cross?
Possibly three.
Right? The mother of Jesus.
Yeah.
Mary Magdalene.
Yeah.
They identified and another Mary,
yeah,
possibly a cousin or something. So, you got to toss some things up. How many, was it Mary Magdalene went to the tomb? Wasn't that the one that went to the tomb, that Mary?
Yeah, but I don't think it was, she's not identified. So what I'm trying
Who's
to do
Who's not identified? I'm sorry.
Mary Magdalene was not
identified
in scripture. No, I'm not talking about the tomb. I'm just talking about this particular scripture.
I know that. I'm just saying that I think traditionally the one that was considered a sinner was said to be Mary Magdalene.
So what you're saying is that maybe the woman depicted in Luke's version being the sinner could have been Mary Magdalene, the prostitute.
Yes.
Correct.
Do you think that they would have mentioned that it was Mary or identified her at that point?
Could have. They did 2 day, 6 day. You know, it's transferring 1,400 different manuscripts. Some nuances might have got a little changed.
Well, no, it was just written. It could have been when he wrote that. It just could have been. Look, they could have both. Here's the explanation for the 2 or 3 days versus the six days. One writer was there on the sixth day seeing it. The other writer was there or maybe heard about it and just wrote about it a few days later or just began to put pencil down, you know, when he heard the story. And it could have been a few days difference, but the incident happened at the same time. just because it was the writer was writing 6 days before the Passover or 2 days before the Passover, doesn't have anything to do with actually when the incident happened. It just that
would, a big thing.
That wouldn't be a theological problem.
What do you think about the incident of her breaking the alabaster box?
I don't think that that's I don't think that that's problematic. I mean, it could have been broken, but it was poured. We know it was poured. So those little nuances are just the writers, you know, putting in things that they believe are pertinent or important. But it doesn't have. It's like if you witness an event, you may write down 4 different characteristics of that event, and somebody else may write down 5. But it doesn't mean that they're inconsistent with one another. They're just different observations.
I think the breaking of the alabaster box was a seal or like opening it.
Yeah,
up.
I mean, it could have been. It didn't have to. I think it was done in a very gentle way, and the breaking could just be breaking the seal and pouring it over. I mean, but that's a good point that these, you know, these depictions aren't inconsistent with one another.
Also, if it was 2 different incidents, then it was 2 different expensive jars of perfume, too, you know, which seems to me a year's wages.
I don't think there's any question that there's 2 different incidents. Look at. There's 2 different incidents.
Right.
It's not the same incident. So we know there's 2 jars. But the reason I believe my theory may in fact be correct is that the characteristics are so unique,
right,
and so different and so unusual. I can't imagine somebody replicating exactly and precisely what this woman sees. This woman was being moved by the Holy Spirit in the first anointing. And it's very consistent that she was moved by the Holy Spirit on the second anointing to prepare for his baptism. Because she knew the first one was for the forgiveness of sins. You know, there's a lot of analogies here. John the Baptist, the forgiveness of sins, the first repentance, right? And then the second one was Jesus. And then this woman was the forgiveness of sins, anointing Jesus. And now the second one is preparation for burial. So I just, look, you got my little scrap paper, and that's how theologians write things. And that, I kind of wrote that out and kind of processed through that for the last few weeks and read these scriptures over and tried to see whether or not there were any inconsistencies in this particular theory, and I can't find them, you know. So, and that's not to say that they're it's a flawless theory. I mean, it takes time to work through these things. I mean, you probably have to go back to the Hebrew, back to the Greek, and really analyze these things. And but I think it's a plausible explanation that we have 2 different incidents with different people at those incidents, a Pharisee, a leper, but yet the same woman may in fact be the same woman in both. And that person is identified as Mary, the sister of Lazarus. It makes perfect sense. Jesus was very close to Lazarus. The sisters loved Jesus. They were all very close to one another. And maybe that could have been initially when he first began to meet this woman, Lazarus' sister Mary. I mean, it makes sense to me.
But that's why Pastor, the first one, they didn't identify Mary. It's just a woman, and the second one they identify as Lazarus' sister.
Yeah, but that's still not inconsistent with the proposition that it may be the same person. See, they don't identify the woman in Luke as Mary. They identify her as a woman that's from the city that's a sinner. They don't identify the woman in the other scriptures either. The only one that identifies her is in John. But we know from John that the woman at Bethany, it's linkage. We know that the woman depicted in John is Lazarus' sister Mary. And it's the same Bethany anointing. So those other 2 scriptures, we know it's Mary in Bethany, right? By her characteristics and how she did the anointing, which was exactly and precisely the same way that was done in the first one, it may be that she's in fact the unidentified woman from the city that's a sinner in the first anointing, and then the progression of her being enveloped with the Holy Spirit and a follower of Christ, and then she's so perceptive as she was in the first anointing that she knows he's going to die. She's got to prepare for burial. That's the theory. All right? Chew on it. Think about it. And
don't choke on it.
But this is what we do.
Chew on it.
On a lighter note,
yeah.
I'm curious if Dr. Kelsey knows what nard it would be. What is nard, the perfume? Are you familiar at all with that?
It's probably a spice that was made in southern Arabia. And the spices from there were wanted all over the world. And they sent them all the way up to Italy. But what they made it, they took some of the gum from trees. It would ooze out of a tree and they hit their gum. And from that they'd make the spice. in the jar, I still think myself, and I'm going to do some research on financing research, that I think that they broke open the cap.
Like Rich said.
Yeah. I don't think they would mess. I mean, it'd be too hard to break up a stone jar. I mean, that's a very hard thing to do. So I don't know, but sometimes they don't get as specific as we would like. They broke it. They broke what?
They'd have a seal on the jar?
Break out the Pepsis or whatever else.
Culturally, do they have a seal on the jar? Is that a cultural thing, like to preserve it for when they get married?
Well, yeah, it could be that they were saving it for something, but
just like a liquor bottle has a seal on it.
They don't want to say somebody knock it over. They don't want the stuff to go
right
down on the floor.
Sure.
So there's a cap in there that's pretty tight.
Yeah.
You want to quote it, Reverend? We're correct on it.
Our Father in heaven, how thankful we are tonight for the fact that you loved us so, that you gave us a book. And in that book, we can learn those things that are so important to know how to walk and to know how to love you. We ask for your blessing now as we get ready for the weekend and as we move into the whole Easter season. We just pray that we'll be led by your Spirit in all the things that we say and do. For we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Don't forget, there's a book here. Someone can take it, and then when you're done reading it, you give it to someone else.
Nobody wants it.
Yes, Rob, thank you for doing that.
My head is spinning. That was so good. It's like. Thank you. It's a very interesting.
There's some of the churches. Some of the
gallon of water.
I forget where the churches are. Some of them believe that it was the same movement, but they don't have any of that.
Ride the basket into it.
So now it's like a stereo. And most say absolutely not. And there's very few people that even believe it's the same woman. But even that, the ones that believe it's the same woman have no theory. You can't just say, well, it's the same woman. You have to explain why. This is one of the earliest. This is very early on. This is toward the end.
What kind of book you had there?
The early on is the first anointing was made when she cried and was for the forgiveness of sins, and then toward the end of his life.
But I bring in a switch spring.
Okay, remember Martin?
Jeff was afraid of
Remember the guy's name? Martin.
So we got to do Martin. M-A-R-T-I-N.
He did a whole thing.
And I thought
she broke down.
Got an extra filter.
excuse me, a number of pagan curious cults. He had a whole series on that.
She used it all. But she used it all the first time, too, because they said it's worth the year.
I thought this time she knew that.
It remember, Jesus' ministry was 3 years. So it could have been, this could have been the beginning of his ministry the first year.
But then again, it
could have been the last year.
Islam was,
I mean, she may have given 2 years of wages to do these two anointings. I don't think that, I just can't imagine another woman doing exactly the same thing that she did.
Well, you don't know women very well.
They do the exact same thing every day. The exact same thing being done. Right? I mean, it's just a very odd thing. It's right. It's the same thing.
You're gonna get killed.
I'll tell you this. I didn't have an answer to that until really recently that I, you know, figured that out. But I mean, a lot of people just assume it was two different people, men, Simons, and two different women.
That they call him Simon the Leper. I guess he was always known by that because that is what he was.
Yeah, even though he was no longer a leper.
Yeah.
Hey, you call me Ricky the Guido.
So I have a different color. You can see better back there.
Put that over your head. Give my nun.
Well, we're new to it.
Simon the Gambler. Don't hit your head.
You have no coat?
I can bring my
coat. Oh,
well,
everybody
probably has.
And I heard Friday is going to be a terrible thing.
Right.
So plan
your day. You know, when you're at Princeton, they have to hit that. And they just have to go so fast. And if you're not right then and there, you're going to be lost.
But you know what you're
lucky? Because they can talk like me. I stop and see if I can have it.
Somebody's phone's still here.
I'm not sure I'll be here.
Well,
you're not preaching on Sunday. I'm preaching on Sunday. Okay.
Did
you
come
to
you?
I better write what's
going
on. All right. Well, if you do, you're
welcome.
Okay, I'm going
to
go.
Did
you take your phone?
Rob, put that back up quick.
Yeah, it was
very good.
Very good study. I enjoyed it.
Well, that's good.
Good.
Right.
Look at all three of them. They don't realize it's the crusaders.
I didn't turn it off yet either.
I unplugged it a while ago. I don't know if that means anything.
No. No. Everybody got to hang out with it.
The weather for Sunday.
Hold on here.
Friday is so bad.